tip of the iceberg. Tonight, with all due respect, I was respected lawyers, counsel Charles Kanjama, and senior counsel Ahmed Asid Abdullahi. Gentlemen, karibu to the program.
Thanks.
Let me start with you, Blair, because you've been vocal about this in the past. And is this a tip of an iceberg, as people asking, oh, this is just, you know, an isolated incident. Like, you know, Chitembwe is the worst of the worst, but, you know, other judges are great.
It's not even the tip. I mean, this is the norm, really. I mean, this is what happens in the judiciary on a daily basis. We confront it every day. Chitembwe is not an isolated case. I mean, there's a Chitembwe in almost every judge, really. So, I mean, this has come out because of, you know, the tapes Sonko brought. But the judiciary has this problem, had this problem. Nobody talks about it. It has become the norm. Whether it's the new Chief Justice or the old Chief Justice, they all know it is. But nobody wants to talk about it. So, corruption in the judiciary, you know, there's this stereotype we always hear that, you know, there's the judges are great, but there's one or two that's a problem. I mean, this corruption is like a business now, and it is judges who run it. And they lobby it, they broker the deals, they bribe their foreign judges. You know, originally people used to say, oh, it's lawyers who broker this. Lawyers have been thrown out of that business now.
How does it work? Give us an in. How does it work?
I mean, it's obviously it comes from the party that wants to influence. It either goes through the lawyer or goes through the judge. But the end result is that someone wants to buy justice at the expense of another. And as lawyers, I can tell you, we confront it on Monday, we confront it on Tuesday, we confront it on Wednesday until Friday. Every day I am in court, I can see it. And you know, you have to fight it, you have to struggle, it's tiring, you know. every day.
Charles, you confront this every day. Do you have a different view?
James, the biggest challenge with corruption, whether it is corruption in the judiciary or any other sector, is that corruption normally takes place willing buyer, willing seller. So you have two people involved in the transaction. And most of the times they are both satisfied with the transaction. They've negotiated. If you are not part of that transaction, what you get to hear is normally rumors, some bit of hearsay, some whispers. You never know when they are completely factual or not. So there's always a tendency to have this kind of like shadowy fear or suspicion that there's corruption in certain cases. I think, James, it would not be very fair to say that it is even the majority of judges, but those judicial officers who may be involved in corruption, they end up spoiling the reputation of the entire judiciary. That's why Judicial Service Commission needs to take a firm action. So what is interesting about the revelations of the last 1 week is that it's no longer rumors. This is audiovisual recording. Of course, we know those who have been accused or implicated have a right to go through a process in the Judicial Service Commission and if found liable before a tribunal appointed by the president. For me, the biggest concern is that the times I have seen the Judicial Service Commission taking action, inevitably, the concerned judicial officers and judges go to court and try to stop the action of the Judicial Service Commission. So if you cripple the very organ that is meant to secure independence and accountability in the judiciary, then it becomes a free-for-all. And the second thing I wanted to say, just to conclude, is that I think the most toxic form of judicial corruption is not the one where you have a willing a buyer who is an individual litigant and a willing seller who is a judge or magistrate or whatever. Yeah. I think the most toxic form of corruption, because it's a cancer that spreads and metastasizes very fast, is where one judicial officer calls another to either broker a deal or speak on behalf of another litigant. I don't know how widespread it is, but I know those cases are the ones that are most toxic, even more toxic than the direct financial corruption, because it spreads the cancer and then ends up infecting so many judicial officers who otherwise would be focused on doing justice without fear, favor, or influence.
But I think the point you are making is that when a judicial officer is trying to influence a judge, I mean, he's not doing as a hobby. He's doing it because he has been instructed or is being paid by a third party to intercede on behalf of that third party to the judge.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not, it's just like any other corruption. But there are a number of things I disagree with my learned friend here is that, first, you know, law is science. And 1 + 1 gives you 2, even in law. And when you see cases that are so straightforward, I've done cases myself where I know that 1 + 1 = 2. But because of, you know, certain influences, which you, and we always see, you know, as a practitioner, the moment the other party in a case I'm involved has done something, I will know from one, I will know from the start that, and most of the times, and we have the misfortune, you know, it's very painful to argue a case before a judge, you know, who has been compromised. I mean, you look so stupid, but you have to do it. And you know that what you are doing is useless because the result has been determined. So, and lawyers, we know, you know, in lawyers know which judge is normally, we know which, who is the clean judge, we know who is the judge who can be compromised. We know, even lawyers, you know, when we're arguing among ourselves, we know who are the lawyers who must do it even before they come to court. So I disagree with my learned friend. I mean, this problem is widespread. This problem has been with us for long. We have tried so many times. I was the chairman of the Law Society when we tried the radical surgery. We fired 50% of the judiciary. It has never happened anywhere in the world. We had a vetting process. We vetted all the judges, but nothing has changed. In fact, in my 28 or 29 years of practice, corruption has never been this perverse in the courts. I mean, it is alarming because now it's the norm, you know. Everybody thinks it is norm. In the old days, people used to do it, but they were very scared. But now, judges know that there is no punishment for this. Nothing will happen to them. My learned friend also said that, you know, the JEC, when it takes, there is an injunction. You should give us an example. Of course, there's one or two cases where someone gets a temporary injunction. The courts dispose of quickly. But the body that has let down Kenyans is the Judicial Service Commission because nothing happens. Complaints piles up. Nobody is processed. I mean, Chitembe's complaint has been there. Yeah, there are many complaints. They do nothing. It's only now that because the Sonko tapes are back that the Judicial Service Commission is doing helter-skelter. PR,
so,
basically.
So I want to say two things here. So you're obviously very optimistic that it's, you say it's a few. And not the majority.
I would like to believe so. What I would say is that even when Transparency International were trying to study corruption, what they would do is what you call corruption perception index. Because it's so difficult to study illegal activity where you have willing buyer and willing seller. Nobody will disclose the evidence. So they used to do corruption perception survey. So what we can do is a corruption perception survey. But in terms of getting actual tangible evidence of corruption in the judiciary, I think it's not so easy to get it. In most cases, what you'll have is more like rumors. That is why even several of the cases that go before the Judicial Service Commission either are not established, or sometimes even you find that the petitioners have withdrawn the cases. I'll give you an example. My colleague Ahmed Nasir has made a certain very scary, shocking allegations about corruption, even at the Supreme Court. And I, as a legal practitioner, when I heard the allegations that Ahmed Nasir made, I said, I'd like to know the truth of the matter. And when I heard that some cases had been filed before JSC, some petitions, I was looking forward to finding out what will be the determination of the Judicial Service Commission. What eventually happened is several of those petitions were withdrawn.
Do you ask yourself why they were withdrawn?
We were left as lawyers wondering, have the facts been tested?
With due respect to Milan, I mean, don't talk like you are from Mars, eh?
Yes.
When you tell us the petition was withdrawn, why don't you ask yourself why it was withdrawn? It's because those very people that were accused of doing the corruption bought the petitioners.
Is this a 200 million case?
No, no, no. It's another one. And you see, I mean, you know, my learned friend is making like we have made corruption against courts are made every day, whether it's the Supreme Court or not. I mean, we know, you know, I mean, you know, this is not, I mean, you want us to bring a sack of evidence and show you how that's not how corrupt this.
What I would say, James, is this for myself.
As a practitioner, yes,
I always want to give the benefit of the doubt to anyone who's accused, even of corruption, whether the person is a fellow lawyer, is a client, or even is a judge or judicial officer. And that is arising from the presumption of innocence. That doesn't mean being naive. It means you give people an opportunity to prove their innocence. I mean, for the accuser to prove their guilt, on the other hand, that is the way a presumption of innocence works. But I do know that it would be naive to say that there's no corruption in the judiciary. My biggest concern is these processes, these mechanisms and these institutions are meant to process the evidence. They don't seem to be working.
You see, corruption, you are looking at a robbery with violence. And then you are saying, where is the tool? Where is the evidence? Where was the victim?
Corruption. So what's the threshold?
Corruption in the judiciary, is found in the judgment. That is the best source of corruption. And I will give you an example. I think there was some time back a judge in Meru. Someone filed a suit, and the judge gave an order removing the deputy chief justice from office, stopping her from acting as I think DCJ. And the judge gave an order. That for me, I mean, you don't need any other evidence. There's no benefit of doubt you give such a person because that judge knows how to remove a judge. He knows how chief justices are removed. But by giving an order, stopping her from doing all her functions must be part of a strategy hatched somewhere, implemented in court. That for me is enough. But that matter went to the JC. What happened? Nothing. So what does that tell judges? It sends a signal that nothing can happen to you because if that judge in Meru is kept and nothing happened to him when he removed the deputy chief justice from office, I mean.
The challenge, James, is that we have been very strong as legal practitioners in campaigning for judicial independence. And we recognize that the first threat to judicial independence is the executive, especially in Africa and in third world countries. They interfere with judicial independence. Another threat to judicial independence, of course, is financial influence or corruption. There's also the decisional independence of the judge. So to ensure that the judge has decisional independence, there have been several decisions by the courts all the way to the Supreme Court that when a judge makes a decision, you cannot use that decision as the principle or sole or primary basis for holding that the judge has committed a misconduct. That if you are dissatisfied with a judgment, your remedy is to seek review or appeal. So this is the jurisprudence that we as practitioners have supported. And I agree with Ahmed to a certain extent. That it has provided cover to those judicial officers who are interested in being
because we're not going to look at the decisions.
Because we're all going to look at the decision. And I've also engaged the JSC myself. I was the chair of the Nairobi branch of LSK for 4 years. And I was engaging the Judicial Service Commission. And I told the commissioners, in my view, the judgment should be part of the substance that can be used in a complaint of misconduct against a judge. But unfortunately, because of the process of decision-making that has come up, you can't just rely on a judgment. You need to have additional evidence. And that additional evidence is what has been lacking in many cases.
You see, it is a deliberate policy by the judges to protect their colleagues when they say that the decision of the judge cannot form the basis of discipline. I mean, when we were doing the vetting, it was provided expressly in the statute that the decision of the judge will play part in his vetting. But what they have done, and the JSC is the main culprit of this, because you act for it. The JSC, not my JSC, the JSC has now decided to have a policy that a judge cannot be disciplined on the basis of decision. But all the mistakes of the judge, I've seen decisions. Suppose a judge says that, I make a judgment that there are three sons in the sky. And then you say you can't discipline him. Because every corruption ends in a judgment. And when you read a judgment, you can see that it is so easy whether this case, a judge has been compromised or not.
Yeah.
It's so easy.
Here's the thing, as we go for a break, because I want to come back and, you know, we go through this conversation. When we interview for the Chief Justice, for instance, one of the key things we ask on the question of the panel is to bring part of their writings so that we gauge the quality of their writing, gauge the philosophy, and, you know, we see how independent they are. So if we ask them for that, why don't we put that as part of the table when there's a problem and there's a crisis, and you say, absolutely, we need to look at some of those decisions. Why is that sort of a misnomer?
I think definitely the quality of judgments is part of the decision making regarding the competence of a judge. Because on the level of competence, of course, the quality of your decisions, how fast you issue them, how often they're overturned on appeal, those are things to be considered. But here we are discussing a topic which is slightly different, even though it's related. Not the level of competence, but the question of being compromised. And the issue is that Ahmed is of the view that by looking at the judgment or the ruling itself, you can say just on the face of it, this judge was compromised. But the position of the law, it's not just in Kenya, by the way, in many countries, is that you can't just use a judgment unless it is so, so obviously wrong that even the common person, a common man or woman in the street, would say this is an absurdity.
So, on that
point, in most countries, disciplining judges start with their judgment. In most cases, because I'm not saying that you crucify a judge or make a determination on the basis of the judgment, but the judgment speaks for the crime scene. If you expect that the judge will be carrying the money in a gunia, you will never find it.
Okay.
You will never find it. It is the judgment that must be the beginning of the process to discipline the judge.
I want to take a short break. Is judgment a crime scene? And should we start from there? But when you come back, the relationship between the executive and the judiciary with this new revelation, what happens next? You watch with all due respect. Don't go too far. I have Senior Counsel Abinasid Abdullahi and Counsel Charles Kanjaba.
Upgrade today and save 50%. Pay 2 months and get 2 months of a higher bouquet. Star Times, your best choice for family entertainment this Christmas.
Get mind-blowing deals every day this November on Jumia. Jumia, kila siku ni Black Friday.
Did you know at Ruiru Mabati Factory, we offer free delivery within the same day? Did you know at Ruiru Mabati Factory, you can open an account and lipa pole pole at your convenience? Did you know at Ruiru Mabati Factory, you can get customized sizes according to your roof plan to avoid wastage? Call us now on 0111-050700. Ruiru Mabati Factory, mali safi kwa bei poa.
TB inatiba. Pata matibabu bila malipo katika hospitali zote za umma. Tujijali tumalize TB. Ujumbe huu umeletwa kwako na Wizara ya Afya na washirika wake.
dije sin pensarlo dos veces, porque te quiero ahí. Y hasta lo espero.
Breaking news from Molfix. Let's see what they're developing right now.
Molfix pants with anatomic fit technology. New Molfix pants, an invention from babies for babies.
You should also try Molfix.
At home, at the office, at the farm, wherever you are, your banking team is at your fingertips. Go digital. Register for our internet banking. Visit coopbank.co.ke.
Welcome back. With all due respect, Advocate Charles Kanjama and Senior Counsel Amin Nasir Abdullahi never allowed me to ask any questions, so I'll ask one question, then I just let them be. So the executive government has been insisting that there's corruption in the judiciary and they have some judges who they can't allow to take plea. We show up months later with a video of a judge, you know, looking compromised, you know, with all due respect. It's a question of, you know, egg and chicken here. So is the government right in the end that there's massive corruption? They actually have a case against these six judges. So, you know, we shouldn't go ahead and swear them in.
I mean, nobody disputes that there's corruption in the judiciary. I mean, apart from few judges who deny and few lawyers, I think Kenyans, there's unanimity that corruption is of the order of the day in the judiciary, from the magistrate court, high court, court of appeal, Supreme Court, it's all there. And I've seen it, and I think nobody can question. But the government is right if it says, you know, that the judiciary has a corruption problem. It's right and it's entitled to. And I think they have a lot of information. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure they have longer tapes than the Sonko tapes, eh? And clearer pictures than the Sonko. But, you know, the government is wrong to play politics in certain specific situations, like these six judges. The government has nothing on these judges. They have been told so many times to bring evidence to the JSC. They have refused to bring. They have, when I think the initial interviews, the JSC has requested the intelligence guys to come and give the evidence. They have refused. So, of course, the government has a lot of information on particular judges. But this particular six judges that they are refusing, I don't think they have anything on them. And it's not fair to characterize those six judges as corrupt just because the government, because now Sonko has brought some tapes mentioning judges.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Charles.
Okay, I think there are two issues. One is definitely what Senior Counsel Ahmed says makes a lot of sense, that if the executive becomes the organ that is responsible for appointing, choosing judges, choosing not to have certain people as judges and so on, it does affect the institutional independence of the judiciary. And that is why the architecture of the Constitution provides for this organ called the Judicial Service Commission, in which the executive is represented through the Office of the Attorney General, two persons appointed by the President representing the public, a representative of the Public Service Commission. So four people that are representing, you could say, the executive. You have five judges represented, the Chief Justice, a representative of Supreme Court judges, Court of Appeal judges, High Court judges, and the magistrates. Then you have two people representing the Law Society of Kenya. So there is a balance, because you see you have 11 members, five judges, four representing executive, two representing lawyers. No side has a majority. So definitely this is the best structure based on our constitution for determining who can serve as a judge. The argument of the president has been that once this process ends, he has been given a constitutional role of appointment, which is not a conveyor belt, but it requires him to substantively appoint, exercising Article 10 considerations of accountability and so on. This matter has been litigated twice in the High Court. Both times the High Court has told the president, you are wrong, your job is ceremonial. The president has appealed to the Court of Appeal, the decision that was made on this issue.
Right.
Unfortunately, that decision or that appeal in the Court of Appeal, until today, it has yet to be heard. So, of course, the president,
why is that?
Because of delays in the process of the hearing of the appeal.
You don't read anything with that?
Well, these are part of the normal delays in the judicial process. What I would say is that when you have a case with high stakes and high significance, the judiciary has a way of expediting those cases, like happened with the Building Bridges Initiative cases, the BBI cases. So what I've been wondering is why this particular appeal cannot be put on the fast track so that we resolve this issue. The president conclusively in the Court of Appeal. Once it is resolved, then if the president loses again, then he appoints the judges. So that has been the challenge. But I would like to make a second point, James, before I finish, which is that 2 weeks ago on a Friday, a three-judge bench of the High Court made a decision that no state organ or officer can present a complaint against a judge to the Judicial Service Commission. So this appeared a bit ironical because, you see, we've been telling the president, if you have an issue against the six judges, take it to JSC. How would the president take it? He's a state officer. He works through state offices of DPP, DCI. If they are now told they cannot take their evidence of whatever lack of integrity or lack of whatever issue they are using to say these judges should not be appointed, if they can't take it to JSC, then where do they take it? And for me, that is the big challenge on this issue, both of judicial appointment and of discipline, which are matters where JSC has a role. There may be some people in the executive, like the president, with a role. The issue is that if you insulate judges from scrutiny by the organ that has been put in the Constitution to provide that scrutiny and to protect their independence and accountability, then it's a free-for-all, and that is my worry.
I mean, the next question here for asking that, you know, when we do not have substantive, you know, sort of process on how to deal with a judge, you know, go to the JSC, and as we've correctly said in the last, what, 20 or so minutes, that we don't have the real evidence. So it's about everyone shouting corruption, corruption, corruption. What happens when we ask the lawyers, 20,000 strong, you know, the law society, what do we say about the lawyers and say, well, he's corrupt, you're corrupt, then we just move on? What happens?
You mean when allegations are made against?
Yes.
You see, I mean, you see, lawyers don't work for the state. Lawyers normally work for a client. And the relationship, you know, that creates a legal, the fact that creates a legal relationship is the one you have with a client. But of course, as a Kenyan, you have also a public duty. And if you are involved in corruption, we have a certain procedure and process. Of course, it's not working very well lately because we have a disciplinary committee that takes through those things. But normally, if a lawyer is involved in such shenanigans like the Sonko, the Law Society has an obligation, or anybody can also bring a complaint against lawyer. Anybody actually can bring a complaint against lawyer and file a complaint in the lawyer's disciplinary committee. So there's that process. It doesn't work well. It's broken down almost. But I think the old days it used to work, but there's that process. But also there's the criminal process, because if a lawyer is involved in either breaking the law or, you know, compromising a court and there is evidence, the government can always, unlike, you know, the judge, which I agree with my learned friend, is now almost completely insulated from the criminal process. The lawyer can always be taken because he's a private citizen. He can be charged with a criminal offense or prosecuted by the organs that
deal. But that doesn't work very well.
Doesn't work, yes.
So we go back to zero. So this relationship that, you know, judiciary obviously, and how most Kenyans access, you know, services is through lawyers. So that process already doesn't work very well. So we see the second step of the judiciary where it's impossible for us to even see the level of corruption in there.
I think those are genuine challenges. Our legal justice system has some flaws. We have flaws in other systems in our country, but now we are talking about the legal justice system. And really it is up to us who have the ability to influence reforms to do so. We thought we had made great strides with the 2010 Constitution, And indeed we had, to a certain extent. But my fear and my concern has been that what we are seeing is two steps forward, three steps back. And we need to start interrogating. And I'm happy that NTV is having this session with us to interrogate what is going wrong. Because if we bury our heads in the sand and don't recognize and acknowledge that there are serious issues at the level of the judiciary, also at the level of some lawyers who are participating in corruption. Even with judges, it is some judges, it is some magistrates. We cannot paint the entire judiciary with a tarnished brush, because there are many hardworking judges and magistrates, there are many hardworking registrars, there are many hardworking officers in the judiciary. But if we don't deal with the rotten apples, and I don't think it's just a metaphor, it's the reality, then the entire bag of apples
goes bad.
Goes bad.
He makes a good point, but you know, Charles, if you look at the history of corruption in the judiciary, it is the corrupted judges that are actually the most hardworking. Yes, yes. If you look at the history of the judiciary, in terms of, you know, the turnaround, in terms of, you know, the judgments, in terms of, you know, how efficient the court is, I mean, if the corrupt judges, and it goes back to the 90s, the corrupt judges are normally very efficient because I think the more decisions they make, the more money they make. But they are very efficient. They make decisions quickly. The judgment comes. Parties are, you know, they are out of their courts very quickly. So hard work actually does not mean that he's doing a good job. Hard work means that he has a very efficient system within his court that probably is geared towards something else than what we see on face value.
So I can add that the standard in the Constitution, it's in Article 166, paragraph 2 of the Constitution, for integrity of judges, is that they should have a high moral character. There is no other state officer in the entire Constitution who has been given that responsibility. For other state officers, their standard of integrity is just chapter 6, which is a high standard. But for judges,
there's an additional
standard. Okay. And so it is true that you can be hardworking and corrupt. You can also be less hardworking and have integrity. Our goal is to have judges who are both hardworking and also with the highest level of integrity.
All right, with all due respect, taking a short break. When we come back, we'll discuss more about how exactly this corruption happens in the judiciary and what we need to do about it. Solution time.
Naitwa Boni Ogol. Brand yangu inaitwa Chula the Shoes. I've won my game through inspiration from when I was a child. I wanted to always own a business. I used to draw shoes at the back of the paper. The future inaka very bright. Ambition yangu ni siku moja now, many people who stock shoes will be buying from us. Tiyote mayata kwanza business, akuambia first, educate yourself. Alafu also jua, pesa ikujangi haraka. Nikitua pole pole.
Hunter's Choice. Own your game.
On the pitch of life, you gotta choose your game and who to play with. Your people. You get what I mean?
Oh, that is so true.
Because when you need a bit of support, it's the people that you can count on. People who are always there for you, no matter what. Choose who to play with.
With BetPower, you can touch, message, or call real people round the clock. This advertisement is brought to you by BetPower.
The Kalasha Awards 2021 are here, and your favorite stars from the captivating NTV show Pieces of Us have been nominated. Vote for Riziki Ambrose, Best Lead Actress in a TV Drama, and Lucarelli Onyango, Best Lead Actor in a TV Drama. To vote, go to the Kenya Film Commission social media pages and click on the voting link. NTV, turning on your world of entertainment.
Honorable adjudicators, parents, teachers, and my students at large, in front of you is Mbogi Academy, ready to present a poem entitled Sherehe. Niko sherehe na itaki hasira. Inataka maponto ameiva. Bill nitalipa hata kama ni kuririma. Mapinji wa kimok, magovana watawanao. Asante.
Get poem ya mbogi. Dial star 811 star 850 hash. Skiza, Nan Nation.
Black, it's not dark, it's bright. Black is bold. Black is every color, all together. My thing, your thing, our thing mixed together. Black shines bright.
The Eldoret National Polytechnic has recorded tremendous growth in development of middle-level training as an institution since inception. It has continually fulfilled its mandate in training young people to acquire skills and technical knowledge that are in line with the industrial growth of our country. The Chief Principal, Mr. Josphat Sawe, cordially invites graduates, students, parents and all stakeholders to its 16th virtual graduation ceremony on 25th November 2021 from 10 a.m. The guest of honor will be Professor George Magoha, Cabinet Secretary, Ministry of Education. The ceremony will be aired live on NTV.
NTV Jioni, habari za kina, fasaha, tendeti na za kuaminika.
Provide retirement saving solutions for everyone. Our products include statutory deductions, additional voluntary contributions, gratuity management, Love Fund Amo, Group Life Insurance, Imarisha, Uma, Ufanisi, and Diaspora Retirement Savings Plan. Love Fund, work, save, retire.
NTV Jioni, habari za kina, fasaha, tendeti na za kuaminika.
Choice raises a toast to you. Cheers to those who dare follow their dreams. Kwa wale watu who chase their goals, whatever it takes. Hunter's Choice. Own your game.
Right, welcome back. You're watching with all due respect. Let's get back into it. Senior Counsel Abin Nasir Abdullahi, the response that I'm seeing for saying that you seem and sound very frustrated with the judiciary and by the courts. What are you going to do about it?
No, I mean, you know, my experience in the courts have been informed. I mean, my attitude in the courts have been informed by my experience, you know, right from the days of radical surgery. I mean, the efforts this country has put into reforms, no country in the world has put in the efforts Kenya has put to reform its judiciary. But I think still it's very corrupt. But I think, I mean, I tell guys that the judiciary as currently constituted is incapable of reforming itself. I mean, the Chief Justice, with tremendous respect to her, has no blueprint on how to fight corruption. I have looked at a 10-year plan. I think it may be a sentence or two, but there's no strategy on fighting corruption.
Should they give her time?
Yes. Of course, we'll give her time, but she has a 10-year program. She has a 10-year agenda.
Yeah.
I mean, fighting corruption is not one of her agendas. Maraga was like that during his 6 years. He has never talked. The last day, and I documented this, the last day when he was leaving, as a farewell speech, is the time he talked about corruption. So the judiciary will never fight corruption because, I mean, they don't see it actually as a big deal. I mean, it's only lawyers and the king and public that makes noise about it. Of course, they're good judges. I've seen many of them that do excellent job, but they are minority. The majority of our courts are rotten to the core. And I'm speaking from my experience, and I have no apologies. And I think even judges, when I see some of them, they agree with me on this point. My view is that the next government must reform the judiciary. And I see a very, we must bring something more radical than the radical surgery and the vetting, something, you know, like a final showdown with the judiciary. Because we have tried radical surgery and vetting, and it has. So I foresee that the next government must address this issue of the judges. And one of the issues is, for example, is there must be an audit on lifestyle. You know, you hear judges buying this, you hear judges building properties. Where is this money coming from? You hear, I mean, I take my kids to expensive schools, but I don't take them to set men to school. When a judge pays $1 million or $1.5 million for a private school, where does that money come from?
He's a good judge.
Yes.
He's a good judge. He's a competent judge.
Good judge's competence is shown in the judgment, not the schools he takes his kids to.
Charles.
Yeah, James.
What's your frustration with the courts?
I think the first thing is I personally don't agree with Ahmed on the question of percentage of corruption in the judiciary. I know that all legal practitioners who are active in practicing in the courts, and the two of us are examples, we do from time to time get frustrated with inexplicable judicial outcomes. And we do from time to time hear whispers or rumors in the court corridors about this or the other thing. But I think it would be unfair and too broad a brush stroke to say that majority of judges and magistrates are corrupt, because there's no evidence about that at all. I personally think that the substantial majority are honest, are clean, trying to work hard and to deliver justice. And they deserve to be commended for that. But even as we commend the majority of judges and magistrates, and that's why we appear before them, and we have some hopes, I think it is important that there is a note of caution. That if judges and magistrates continue covering for their brother and sister judges and magistrates, when they are facing inquiries of accountability, then it is going to allow the rot to spread fast, and to spread like wildfire.
Just a little. The biggest problem Kenya is facing is people apologizing for a corrupt judiciary. That's the big. We have seen it in the 90s, we have seen it in the 2000s, and it's continuing.
Is that what you're hearing from Charles?
Apologize, you know, apologizing and making excuse for corrupt judiciary will not help this country. My learned friend knows, like I do, that corruption is the order of the day in our courts. We face it every day as legal practitioners. Some of us walk away, they don't talk about it. Some of us talk about it, complain about it, and confront it on a daily basis. But let us not apologize. Let us address this issue and say that there's a national problem we are facing as a country, which is a corrupt judiciary. How do we address it? Once we raise that question, even the judges may think, sorry for their country and stop this issue. But if you apologize for them, if you say that, oh, majority, okay, there's a rotten apple here and there, I mean, you are allowing that intolerable status quo to continue and flourish.
The last time you're here, you said you do not mind a corrupt judge. It's about 2 months ago. Has that changed?
No, actually, I said I don't mind a corrupt judge that is silent. But I feel offended when a corrupt judge pontificates about the virtue of a good judge. That's what I said. And I was using in the context of a certain politician, okay, because okay. I don't mind a corrupt politician, but I don't like a politician who is corrupt, who will tell me that he will jail all the corrupt Kenyans when he's one of the biggest.
Charles, are you making apologies for this rampant corruption?
Let me say that I completely associate myself with what former Chief Justice William Mutunga said in one of his speeches. I think it must have been a colloquium in Mombasa for judges, in which he addressed them and he told them that if you're going to be corrupt, just resign, leave the judiciary and go and make money in private practice. No one is stopping you from going to private practice to make money. But for God's sake, don't be corrupt while you're a judge. I think I associate myself with those sentiments, and there is a place for that moral exhortation that has to be repeated occasionally to every staff or officer of the judiciary. I don't agree that Chief Justice, the current Chief Justice that we have in Kenya, Martha Koome, doesn't have a plan to deal with corruption. I think we need to give her time. But it is also true that even as we give her time, we need those who are frustrated about corruption in the judiciary to speak out. Because if we don't speak out, if we remain silent, everyone will think things are okay. So I do sympathize with what Ahmed has said in terms of the need to avoid apology, groveling apology. In fact, I call it groveling apology that sometimes we lawyers become very proficient in, for the very simple reason that tomorrow I'll be before a judge, the next day I'll be before a magistrate.
And
they may take offense, and they do take offense, because they are our colleagues, but they're also human beings.
Yeah.
And I do know that sometimes they do take offense very righteously, because if you accuse me of corruption, I have a family, I have children, I go to church, you're basically tarnishing me, and you don't have evidence against me as an individual. I do sympathize with judges as well. But I do know that sometimes lawyers may lay it on very thick, the apology, not because they really mean it, but because deep down they hope to get a favor from that judiciary. And that is why I think the honest thing to do, even for us, the thing that has integrity, is to call out judicial corruption when we see it, to call out incompetence when we see it, but also to appreciate and compliment those judges who are working hard when we see it.
You know, James, just a small clarification. In the history of, you know, fighting corruption, and we know a lot of things, the test is that if you hear someone telling you, give me the evidence on corruption, that means don't waste your time. Mm-hmm. I have no time for this. I remember when Rachel Omamo was the chairman of the Law Society, and we went to the Chief Justice, Bernard Chunga, and she complained, you know, she was our chairman. So we told her, you know, we told him that corruption has become perverse, there is all these things. Then he said, you are the counsel of the Law Society, go and get me the evidence. I will remove all the judges. But of course, the evidence he is asking for is the evidence that can convict someone on a murder case. Well, nobody has that kind of evidence. And I think that's the evidence by Leonard Friend is alluding to. This issue of evidence is a euphemism that we don't want to touch this. Business as usual. If you can't bring the money that has exchanged hands, then don't waste your time. That is the evidence he's talking about. And you will not get that evidence. There is nobody who can, even the government cannot give you that evidence of money exchanging hands. The one who's given the bribe and the judge taken, you have to be, I mean, when you are addressing ethical issues of corruption in a justice sector, the threshold, my friend, is very low. The threshold is very low.
For me, what I would say is this.
Yes.
One, we have to avoid the temptation of becoming a lynch mob. The lynch mob is the one that works without evidence.
Do you think that's what's happening in this case?
It's a danger. And I think the insistence by senior counsel Ahmed will open the gates for the lynch mob. The lynch mob likes throwing stones. and they do it without evidence and on the basis of rumors. Yet I also agree with him that the evidence that is required cannot be at the level for a criminal case of beyond reasonable doubt. The standard of evidence has been established for the Judicial Service Commission is on the face of it, what we call prima facie evidence, that there is something that you need to answer to. Once that level of evidence has been established, then you recommend a tribunal formed by the president in which the standard of evidence is not beyond reasonable doubt, is on a balance of probabilities, which means 50-50. And it is on that basis that a judge would then be removed from office, or indeed any other state officer. So I agree that...
But we're having a problem with that. That is not happening as it should.
It's not happening for a number of reasons. One of the reasons is that there are people who are withdrawing complaints to JSC, like Ahmed's former client. The second is that sometimes JSC itself delays in dealing with these matters. The third is that even when they try to deal with the matter speedily, their processes are being interfered with by the courts. Those are the real reasons.
I mean, Kenya, if you look at from 1963 to now, and you check how many judges have been removed through tribunals, maybe 3-4. Yes.
It shows, so what do we do, according to you, as we make a final point?
It's actually the way to address corruption in the judiciary is not through the constitutional structure system we have. It needs more policy decisions from government, because this is no longer a problem. I mean, the JSC has failed in this matter. The judiciary's leadership have no interest in fighting. Just the way the radical surgery was brought from outside, the way vetting came from outside. The judiciary, you know, is a very protective institution. It's an institution that protects its membership. I mean, you will never see a judge condemning another one, even when they know that he is corrupt. So it is, as we look into the politics of this country next year, the reform of the judiciary must come as a political process outside the judiciary.
Here's a thought. You've practiced for 29 odd years. Yes. You've made your money. You're a comfortable man. Why don't you go into the judiciary and apply for, you know, a job as a judge or a chief justice, whatever it is, to clean it, because you know what needs to happen?
No, but...
Why don't you do that?
It's not the judges there who will clean it.
No, but, I mean, leadership position, like, what is... Why don't you do that?
No, I mean, if it comes, maybe I've said many times I'm not interested, but what I want is, the role I play is very important, and I've played this for so long, and we have had good results, you know, when I was chairman and we... You know, the Kibaki government, we played a role on the radical surgery, we played a role in the vetting, we played a role in bringing new judges, which was an improvement on how the old ones were appointed. But I know that even some of the judges I interviewed myself, some of them my classmates, some of them my contemporaries, some of them I vouched for, when I see what they do, you know, I feel so disappointed, because I don't know when the rot starts, you know. Is it in the judiciary? Is it the atmosphere that's conducive for this kind of things? Because I've seen people with virtues, you know, people who want to reform the judiciary, people who have great ideas going into the judiciary. Then the next time you hear that, oh, this has happened, this has happened, this has happened. So in my view, respectful view, the judiciary cannot reform itself, and it cannot address the corruption problem it faces.
30 seconds, final thoughts, Sir Charles.
It's difficult to have final thoughts because this is a continuing conversation.
We will bring you again, but you're
interim.
Yes, but I can say that I served one term in the Council of the Law Society of Kenya, 2012 to 2014, and that was during the height of the vetting process. And one of the cases I handled on behalf of LSK, we went all the way to the Supreme Court, was to insulate the vetting process from review by the very judges who are being vetted because of the inherent conflict of interest. And it is only because we succeeded in that battle that went from the High Court to the Supreme Court, and there are many senior lawyers who are on the other side, that the vetting process had some measure of success. My parting shot, my closing thoughts is this, that until the time we reach where the judges are able to restrain themselves from interfering in the mechanisms and processes of institutions that are external to the judiciary, that is the Judicial Service Commission, the investigating organs like EACC,
DPP
and DCI,
yes.
DPP,
yes.
When they try to make judges accountable. Unless we reach that point, then it is inevitable that we'll inexorably go towards that point where the judiciary can no longer be accountable or reform itself, and external forces will then affect or damage the independence of the judiciary as they try to pursue the accountability.
5 seconds. You were dying to say something.
No, I think I disagree with the last point he makes.
But your final thoughts.
Yes. But I think protecting the judiciary is very important from, you know, this external place he's talking about. I don't want the DCA to rush because the government is unhappy with the judge. But I also agree that the judiciary has created a certain jurisprudence that almost makes it impossible to discipline judges. And that's why I'm saying disciplining the judges now ultimately must come from outside the judiciary.
Okay. Thank you very much. Now, Sonko's Facebook page is a vortex of gripping and compelling entertainment. For me, it's not even the morality of things, because you cannot have a discussion about morality if culture and humanity are also not sitting at the table. By the artistry of the unfolding story is the story for me. Now, the former governor serves names, faces, receipts, voice recordings, body parts in an episodic saga strong in its thematic focus and shock value. And this is why Sonko's ratchetry, if you call it, is to me a beautiful thing. He's showing us where we are at a high level of dysfunction and brokenness. The loneliness and alienation we feel on our own are but secondary effects of living in a system that alienates and divides us on a daily basis. It makes us hateful and suspicious of each other. It offers no joy to live. One could argue that all this is just part of Sonko's world, and that this is his chicken simply coming home to roost. But whether we choose to believe it or not, we are all implicated in this web of events in some way. Yes, it's an opportunity for entertainment, but it's also an opportunity for consciousness. An opportunity for us to see if the mirror reflected by Mike Mvuvi Sonko and all his compatriots is what we want to continue to project and hand down to our children. Or if we have gotten to the place where we have truly had enough and will only accept a better way. Because there is a better way. Smart Point Tonight is courtesy of our free thinker, Kino Kamenshu. We do this every Tuesday in our program. My name is James Smart. Sleep well. We'll see you on social media.
TV.
Malaria!
That's why you need the superior protection of
Mortine!
Mortine 360 degree reach. Only this has 11 fans which enable it to reach the farthest corners. Mortine, total indoor protection.
The Eldoret National Polytechnic has recorded tremendous growth.